Thank you, Gloria. I realize this is a larger than normal audience, and so can you hear me in the back here so far? Very difficult, huh? All right, I'll try to bellow as much as I can and try not to blow the eardrums of the people in the first row. So just to give you an idea of the format, again, I'm going to talk 45 minutes to an hour. Those of you who have seen my talks before, it's a lot of slides. I go through them relatively quickly, a lot of data. So at any time, if you're not understanding the point I'm trying to make, it's likely that everybody else isn't understanding it either. So you can do us all a favor by raising your hand, asking a question, ask me to slow down. I always tell my students to do this. Of course, they're too busy buying shoes on Amazon.com on their laptops, but none of you have laptops here, so I know you're all paying attention to me. My topic today is, what else, Donald Trump? I want to cover two topics. One, I'm going to focus on how did he win election, and then second, very briefly, I'll talk about some of the implications for the country as far as we can tell. And I start with a question here, who could have predicted this? Who? And I'd like to say I predicted it. I did not. But I have spent the last year on academic leave prior to coming back to teach at Middlebury in September. And during my academic year, I originally had a plan to write the definitive work on the White House staff, but then Donald Trump came down the escalator at Trump Tower back in 2015 in June. And I write a blog, a presidential power blog, and I immediately wrote a very humorous, satirical take on his presidency, and I got it out there in 24 hours because I knew his candidacy was going to disappear in about 3 weeks, max. And of course, being the expert on elections, I told everybody I knew, my students, my parents, the media, unfortunately, that he had no chance of winning the nomination, never mind becoming president of the United States. Well, when that became clear that that wasn't happening, that every time he made an outrageous statement, his poll numbers went up, I scrapped my plan to write the definitive book on the White House and said, I need to figure out what's going out here. And I began to follow him around the country. And my journeys took me from Vermont to New Hampshire, down to South Carolina, to Florida, back up to New York, and culminating in the Republican National Convention in Cleveland, Ohio, where I went not as a delegate, but as a blogger. They stuck me up in the nosebleed seats. And I came and gave a talk here in late August, before the general election had started, and I sort of talked about why he had won the nomination, very briefly, without summarizing that entire talk too quickly. I thought there were several issues. One, he was smart enough to catch on that this was the year of populism. Economic populism, but also political populism. There was enough dissatisfaction with both parties that he was able to craft a policy stance that was not traditional liberal, but it was certainly not traditional Republican conservative. It was a blend of both issues. So, for instance, he appealed to those people who thought the Democratic Party has been overrun by pointy-headed urban professionals and non-white voters, but practicing identity politics. He also attracted Republicans who were tired of social conservatives and free market capitalists dominating their party. So one, he had a nice mix of issues, trade being perhaps the one that's most associated, but that spilled over into issues like immigration and security of our borders. There is an implicit racial appeal, whether you want to call it racial bigotry, as many on the left do, or simply opposition to race-based identity politics, as those on the right do. He clearly appealed to people who are, for whatever reason, very uncomfortable with pushing identity politics on the basis of race. Third, he was a master, and we probably shouldn't be surprised at this, at using free media. Getting outsized television coverage, not only in the debates, but call-in talk shows, and not least, Twitter. He will be our first president to be the tweet in chief, right? Or as I like to call him, the chief twit, right? And you know, we're gonna see how that works out when 3 a.m. he decides to make a diplomatic decision and tell everybody in 140 characters or less. Fourth, as a non-politician, he could correctly say, I'm not part of the problem. right? I've never held elected office, and that appealed to a lot of people who were basically upset with both parties. And finally, there were 16 other Republican candidates, and as much as the establishment didn't want Donald Trump to be the nominee, they also weren't sure who the alternative should be. And so they dissipated their support among these 16 other candidates. Donald picked them off one by one through the Iowa caucuses, and next thing you know, I'm in Cleveland watching this guy get coronated as the Republican nominee. And that raises the question, could he win the general election? By the way, that's my genuine Donald Trump Make America Great Again hat, which I paid $22 for among all the stash that I picked up on these campaign trails. You can see all the badges I have and everything. But my favorite is the cap. Of course, where is that cap made? Yes, that's right, China. Make America cap is made in China. All right, could he win the general election? The pundits said no. There's no way he could win the general election. That's, of course, Nate Silver, pundit in chief. And this is basically Silver's polls only forecast from June through November. He never had Trump going above 50%. It rotated as low as 15%. On the eve of the election, he gave Trump's chances about 30% of winning. That actually was optimistic. Compare that, for instance, to an open crowdsource poll, which was much more stable, but also never gave Trump much of a chance, maybe 25%. It's easy to pick on Nate Silver. Why not? But he wasn't the only one. By the way, he's now been changed to Nate Bronze. He was one of the less wrong. PhD students, my old alma mater, where I got my PhD degree. So much for their expertise in predicting the electoral votes for Clinton. Only two of them thought she would we'd have a President Trump. Prediction betting markets, everybody talks about, well, when you have to put your money on an outcome, you tend to be a little more judicious of your choices, and so the prediction markets are going to get it right. At no point did they say, basically, you translate these for, this is how much you can trade stock in Hillary Clinton, and basically, you get paid off for a dollar. Translate this into a probability, never less than 60% chance of winning. By the eve of the election, they had her chances closest to 90% chance of winning. This is the predicted market, right? Another one, betting market. This is the flip side. What are the chances of Donald Trump winning? Less than 20%. Interesting enough, after he won election, the chances of him becoming president went up to almost 100%, but not quite 100%. So they're still wondering if something might happen before the actual inauguration. This was an aggregate measure. Polyvote is a website that puts together expert forecasts by so-called experts. And again, they translated that into percentages. And on the eve of the election, they had her winning 52.5% of the vote, which actually was pretty close. And the Electoral College prediction, I haven't talked about that, but there were also predictions made about that. Again, this was a composite prediction of all the political scientists and various other experts, and it came out on average that she would win 323 electoral votes, including winning, most certainly, Wisconsin and Michigan and Pennsylvania, those states that we knew would never go Republican. All right. And the polls themselves, this is an aggregate. Each one of these dots is a poll. Blue means Clinton's ahead. Red is the Clinton support, that's the Trump support, and you can see aggregating them together, which is what this line says. At no point in the HuffPost aggregate pollster did Donald Trump move ahead in the polls. On the eve of the election, and again, this is including third-party candidates, Clinton was predicted to get 47% of the popular vote, Trump 42% of the popular vote. All right. And you might say, well, we can't trust Nate Silver, but you can trust the polls. Basically, when I gave my talk here, it was about 100 days before the election, I said, pay no attention to the polls. This is a measure, it's basically a coefficient that says what is the relationship between the polls and the actual outcome. If it's zero, that means there's no relationship. And in fact, 300 days before the election, the polls tell us nothing about who's going to win. But not surprisingly, the closer you get to the election, the more reliable the polls become, generally speaking. And now this is going back to 1956. So we're just sort of aggregating all these. So by the time of election day, the polls are not quite 100% predictive, but they're pretty darn reliable. So on the eve of the election, when we saw these polls showing Hillary holding the lead, naturally, and I hate to say this, but had you brought me in then to give a talk, I would have said, well, Hillary's probably going to win this race based on the polls. Fortunately, you didn't bring me in then. All right, so there we have it. Quite clear, we're going to have Madam President, right? Newsweek had their cover all printed up, ready to go. Donald Trump, wondering and suspenseful on the day, who's America going to vote for? Never mind America, who's Melania voting for, right? Jeez. And like father, like son. Yeah. Well, who's she voting for? Of course, who's he voting for? I have no idea. I'm assuming Clinton, since Bernie was out supporting him. All right, what happened? Well, as you know, we had our own Dewey defeats Truman moment, right? No Hillary Clinton as president. Why were so many experts wrong? Well, the immediate response was to blame the polls. This is an old historical reference. The Literary Digest was a magazine in 1936, conducted the first presidential poll, and based on the responses they got, they predicted Alf Landon to win overwhelmingly. Ever heard of President Alf Landon? No, you did not. And so we had sort of a reprise of this. The reality is, on the national level, the polls actually weren't any worse off than they were in 2012. This is the absolute error in 2012. By absolute, I mean some polls had Clinton up too much, some had her down too much. But on average, the polls were off by about 2%, 2.7 from her actual vote total, his actual vote total, I'm sorry, in the 2012, the Obama-Romney race, and they were about the same in 2016. So in the aggregate, the polls were no worse. But what happened was at the state level, the polls were off, and they were systematically off by underestimating Donald Trump's support in key states. So what we have here is where the state polls had the race, 5% Democrat would be right about here, and this is where they actually ended up. So you can see almost every one of the polls in the end result moved towards Donald Trump. In other words, Trump did better in each of these states' polls, in the election returns, than the polls said he would. There is a systematic polling error that underestimated Donald Trump's support, right? And as a result, there was a lot of egg in faces. Another way of looking at this is the poll aggregates in each state. This is what you are going to get based on the polls. And this was the vote share minus the poll aggregate. In other words, if you finished above this line, you did better than the polls suggested in each of these states. If you finished below this line, you did worse than the polls. Notice the polls on Hillary. Some of them overstated her support. Some of them understated. On average, they were probably pretty close to zero. Now look at Donald Trump. Every one of the state polls basically underestimated his final vote total. So there was a last, and we can figure out why this was, but the plain fact of the matter is those people like Nate Silver who make a living predicting elections, they rely on the polls. There's no magic sauce that he has. He just looks at the poll. I hate to break the news to you, but that's his formula. His formula for who's going to win the election is, who do the polls say are going to win the election? That's who's going to win the election. Turns out that's usually reliable. It wasn't reliable this year, right? And we got some indication of that in some states. In Pennsylvania, the polls on October 30th had Hillary Clinton up, but by the time you got to November 6th, you could see they were tightening. This is the margin of error. This is Clinton. This is Trump. They were getting closer to zero, but except for that very last one, the margin of error really never predicted a Trump movement. So we picked up some movement towards Trump, but not a Trump victory. Wisconsin, there weren't enough polls, but those that they were showed no trend towards Donald Trump. Michigan, again, this was a poll on October 27th. This is the poll and the day before the election, and his margin really hasn't changed to a great degree through that time. So for those states in which we had polls in the last week, we weren't picking up any late trend to Donald Trump. We just weren't seeing any evidence that Trump was going to win. So I confidently told my students, I have a weekly politics luncheon on the day of the election, don't bet the house on it, but maybe you want to bet your kids' tuition that Hillary Clinton is going to win this election if the polls are right. Now again, one big complaint about the polls is they're not ironclad predictions. They are probability estimates, and a lot of people sort of get that wrong. Many people confuse forecasts with fortune telling. A fortune teller seeks to predict the future with certainty, an endeavor that I view with suspicion. Statisticians use available information to help us make better decisions when we can't be sure what will happen in the future. So there was always uncertainty involved with polls. Another way of looking at that visually, here's the three poll-based major forecasts by Nate Silver, the New York Times, and HuffPost. And I won't go into detail how they do this. Basically, anytime you take a poll, it's a snapshot of the population. Say it says there's 51% of people in this poll who support Clinton. Well, there's a confidence interval. So we know with some probability it's likely to be 51 in the real world, but it could be 50, could be 49, could be 52. Well, if you put those estimates into a computer and run sort of a Monte Carlo simulation, in other words, you just rerun these polls with all the probabilities playing out, add up all the possible results, the black dots are every time that Trump might win. The white dots are every time that Clinton might win. So out of 1,000 simulation based on the polling data, Silver said, well, 286 of those, Trump wins. New York Times was a little more bullish on Clinton's chances, only had Trump winning 150. The poor HuffPost only had him winning 20. But the point is, it wasn't impossible that Trump was going to win. It was just unlikely that Trump was going to win. A lot of people forgot this, right? There's a margin of error. This is a probability. It's not a complete certainty when we're making these predictions. All right, so much for the pollsters, the pundits. What about the political scientists? Well, the political scientists, every 4 years, put together a forecast model. That model is based on an underlying logic that says something like this. When things are going well in the country, we reward the party in power, particularly the president's party. When things aren't going so well, we punish the president's party. What do we mean by going well? If the economy is expanding, if our disposable income is going up, on average, looking back at a number of elections, we can predict with a certain level of confidence what the result will be in the popular vote share, right? That's all our forecast models do. So here's two models, one based on the change in gross domestic product. So from the first quarter of the year to the third quarter of the year, how big has the economy grown or has it contracted? And as you can see, here's the zero point. When the economy contracts, as it did in 1980, the share of the incumbent party is below 50%. Jimmy Carter wins about 45%. When the economy is growing, as was the case, for instance, in Bill Clinton's 1996 re-election bid, the party in power, that would be Clinton, and the Democrats are rewarded. He gets 55% of the two-party vote. So each one of these elections is a data point. And based on all these data points, we can sort of create a model that says this is the real relationship between growth or change in gross domestic product, and the share of the popular vote. Not the Electoral College vote, the popular vote. And we can do the same if our measure of how the economy is doing is real disposable income per capita. In other words, how much money do people have in their pocket on average? Is it growing or shrinking? Same relationship. When the economy is getting better, the vote total of the incumbent party goes up. Very intuitive, very basic, very simplistic, but pretty darn good. And essentially it tells us not that campaigns don't matter, but that when you're running for the presidency, if things are going well, you want to campaign on that. You want to point out that things are going well. So this provides the raw material on which the presidential candidates construct a campaign strategy. When things are going poorly, you run, if you're the opposition candidate, by pointing out things are going horribly. Look at GDP, look at disposable income. So a lot of people are skeptical of these models, but they actually are pretty good. So what did they say in 2016? This is where I ended my talk here. They actually said, this is going to be a fairly close election. Now, each one of these is a different model. There's actually many more. I'm going to show you the summary of them. But the important thing is all of these forecasts are made roughly 100 days to maybe 60 days before the election. In other words, before the debates, before the gaffes, before the general election campaign, we have a pretty good idea of how this election is going to turn out, assuming both candidates play their parts and run campaigns based on these fundamentals, right? So here are the models. And as you can see, this model predicts the Democratic portion of the two-party vote is 50.4%, Republicans 49%. This one predicts the Democrats 51%, Republicans 48%. This one has the Republicans 51%, Democrats 48%. So they're all sort of in saying this is going to be a very close election. Now the models differ. There's a couple other variables. They might include how long has the incumbent party been in office. We know it's harder to win a third consecutive term than a second consecutive term. How popular is the incumbent president? You get the idea here. But here's how I make my prediction. I add all the models up and I take the average of the forecast, or actually I rely on the median prediction. And the median prediction of all these forecast models, which is how I ended my talk in August, was, and at this point, Hillary Clinton was up by about 7%. I said, this race is going to close. It's going to be tight. Democratic popular vote, two-party vote, probably going to be 50-49. Basically, too close to call. It's going to be a dead heat. But we should expect a very close race. That's how I left the talk. Everybody grumbled, said, you don't know what you're talking about. Which is normally a safe reaction when I give lectures. So what was the actual vote this election? Clinton, 51%. Now we're still counting votes in California. Trump, 49%. So pretty good for government work. In end of August, we pretty much predicted what this was going to be, and it's turned out that way. Thank you. Any questions? Alas, we don't elect presidents by the popular vote, do we? No, we elect them by the Electoral College vote, and I made no predictions about the Electoral College vote because we aren't very good at that. But just to drive home the point, here are two fundamentals. This is second quarter GDP growth. This is presidential approval. And based on presidential approval, what would we predict the incumbent party, the Democrats, Clinton, to have won? Almost exactly, this is the line, the relationship between presidential approval. Would have predicted her to be right about there, and that's exactly where it was, based on Obama's approval. How about if we looked at second quarter GDP growth? It was about 1%. Would have put her right about here, exactly where it ended up. So in all these election cycles, it turns out this year was one of the ones that was most consistent with our forecast models. All right, so if we look at one more, this is the change. Remember I talked about the change between quarter one and quarter three. Based on the current change, where would it predicted she would have won? Right here, about 51% of the vote, which is almost identical to what she got. So in a lot of respects, this is a very, very predictable election. Right? Despite the fact that everybody got it wrong. Now remember, these models don't use polling data at all. They don't care if Hillary Clinton is running or Chelsea Clinton is running. They don't care if Donald Trump is running or Jeb Bush. They use generic candidates. They pay no attention to who the candidates are. They make a simple assumption, which is candidates are going to maximize reality in ways that increase their likelihood of winning the election. If both of them do this properly, we should be able to make a good approximate guess of the outcome just based on looking at measures of that reality. Any questions about that? All right. And again, I'm not even going to read this. All you need to know is the political science forecasts, again made months before election day, were much more accurate than the polls, even the polls taken on the day before the election. That's all you need to know. In sum, in addition to being stable, transparent, and early, most of the political science presidential election forecasts were accurate. Some were, by any standard, extremely accurate. Better, in fact, than the major national polls collected by Real Clear Politics or the Polls Plus forecast of Nate Silver in 538. So my arm is sore from patting myself on the back as a political scientist, but we did really well this year. But of course, there's this problem. Sure, we can predict the popular vote, but how relevant is that when it turns out Donald Trump, contrary to state polling, won Pennsylvania, won Michigan, and won Wisconsin, and as a result, he got 306 electoral votes, she only had 232. Well, normally, the popular vote tracks pretty closely to the Electoral College vote. I can show you this. Here's the popular vote on each of these dots, and here is the percentage of Electoral College votes won by the winning candidate. And it's very rare that you see a difference in which the popular vote and the Electoral College vote differ in terms of who the winner is. But that's what happened this year. Trump wins 47.5% of the popular vote, but he wins 57% of the Electoral College vote. Note that the Electoral College vote, the share you win, the percentage of Electoral College votes, is always greater than the popular vote share because of the way we allocate Electoral College votes, right? In every state, you win the most popular votes, you get all the Electoral College votes. So you get nothing for finishing a close second. This is not hand grenades, right? This is not horseshoes. This is the Electoral College. So finishing second means you get no Electoral College votes. Finishing first means you get a lot of Electoral College votes. So there's a tendency to have a greater proportion of the Electoral College than the popular vote. And some people say that's a good thing. We can even measure that. What's the relationship? What's the inflation factor? Typically, your electoral vote share is about 1.36 times bigger than the popular vote share. Trump's actually was lower this year. It was only about 1.2 times bigger. No different than Obama in 2012. He had the same inflation. The difference, of course, is the election was closer. So the popular vote fell below the Electoral College 50% margin. All right, another way to look at this, if we look at the vote by county, look at this. This is Donald Trump. This looks like a red America, right? And again, this is just a reminder that when it comes to allocating the vote, Republicans are much more efficiently distributed nationwide than are Democrats. Increasingly, Democratic supporters are clustered on the right coast and the wrong coast, in large urban areas like San Diego in LA, New York, Washington, D.C., the Amtrak corridor, but in the great heartland, it's Republican, right? Another way of looking at this, let's take all of Clinton's support out. What does the country look like? This is a lake, but these aren't lakes. This is just the place where Democrats have the majority. Looks like a country we could recognize. You know that's the United States, right? Maybe it's more impressive if we look at where Hillary won, right? That's Hillary's America. Right? Much smaller geographically. But of course, we don't allocate the presidency based on geographical units. It's based on, well, we do, but it's popular vote within states, not counties. In fact, if you want to think about geography versus population, Hillary Clinton support is basically, she won 15% of America, 530,000 square miles. Trump won 85% of America, 3 million square miles. That seems pretty lopsided until you remember in that 15%, there's about 174 million people, where in that 85%, there's about 46% or 148 million people. So he was winning a lot of places populated by cows and sheep and people. She's winning a lot of places populated by Starbucks and people, right? And don't worry about that, because that is updated. All right. Another way of thinking about this is not who won or lost a state or a county or a congressional district. What's the relative percentage of vote? Dark red, Trump wins over 90%. Dark purple, Clinton wins over 90%, and then you shade in between. And you can see, you know, we're not really a red state or a blue state, we're kind of a purple state. Some places a little more purple, and some places a little more red, but there are Democrats and supporters everywhere. I bet if I asked you to give me a show of hands here in blue state Vermont, right, I bet there'd be a lot of people who say they're Republicans right here. They won't admit to voting for Trump, but I know there's a lot of Republicans in this audience, right? All right, so why did he win the general election? A couple of big things he was able to do. He boosted the vote among lower educated white voters in those swing states like Wisconsin and Pennsylvania and Michigan. And the Obama coalition turned out not to be a Clinton coalition so much. African American turnout was down slightly. Latino turnout was up, but a lot of it went for the third party rather than her. In retrospect, should we be surprised? Probably not, that African American support for Hillary Clinton was not at the historical levels it was for Barack Obama. It was still pretty high, but it wasn't historically high. It went back to how it was in 2004 for John Kerry and 2000 for Al Gore. The most important thing to take away from this election, though, partisanship trumped everything. So national exit polls showed Clinton winning 89% of vote among Democratic identifiers, Trump winning 90% among Republicans. These percentages precisely match those in 2008, the last time there was no incumbent president on the ballot. When we had the incumbent president in 2012, the percentages were slightly higher. So what does this mean? For all the hand-wringing from the Republican establishment about Trump and how he was killing the party, in the end, when it came down to the vote, most traditional Republicans held their nose or did not hold their nose and voted, as they always do in recent decades, Republican. And most Democrats, for all the hand-wringing about how Hillary was disliked, voted Democrat. There was no real change in the drive of that. There was change, however, in some of the vote among racial and ethnic minorities. So again, if we compare 2000 up through 2016, we can see here's the relative net vote for Donald Trump. He lost by 80% among African Americans, a big number, but not as much as Romney lost and McCain lost in 2012. He lost among Latinos by 36%, but despite the predictions that the Latino vote was going to crater and go entirely for Clinton, actually he did better among Latinos than did Mitt Romney in 2012, who said immigrants would self-deport, about the same as John McCain. Among a very small Asian American turnout, he again did better than Mitt Romney. And he boosted the white support to the biggest it has been since 2000. That's really the election there. This election turned on roughly 200,000 votes in three states. And just marginal movement among key voting blocks in those states led to a President Trump instead of a President Clinton. So black turnout was down, 8% support. It's actually slightly more, as you saw. It was down in particular in key areas. The Milwaukee County area in Wisconsin, Detroit's Wayne County area in Michigan, African American turnout was down, and we saw similar patterns of lower urban turnout in Philadelphia and other cities in the Midwest. So many of these voters were likely minorities who Democrats assumed would support the party in large numbers, but they simply did not vote in as great a number as they did in 2012. All right, Latino backlash. By sheer size, Latino vote went up 1%. All these are based on, again, exit polls. Went up from 10% in 2012 to 11%, but they didn't turn out for Clinton in bigger numbers than Obama. In fact, a significant number, 6%, went for the third party, Jill Stein, Gary Johnson. And as a result, Clinton actually only got 65% to 71% for Obama. Trump got 29%, increased his support among Latinos, relevant to Romney. Racial resentment, in general, seemed to be less of a factor than we predicted it would be. He did better than Romney among blacks, Latinos, and Asian Americans, making it difficult to claim that racial resentment was the dominant factor driving Trump's support. Other big groups, suburban areas and white women voted for Trump in very similar proportions. Actually, he did better among the suburban vote, 59% for Trump, 50%. Interestingly, white women who had voted for Romney, 56%, went for Trump by 52%, right? Despite those comments he made and those ads Clinton was running about his misogynistic comments, he won. But here's the biggest, and to me, this is the biggest story of the election. There has been a widening education gap. Professionals, postgraduates, went to Clinton by a slightly higher margin than Obama. They were 18% of the electorate in both elections, but their support for the Democrat went up by 3 percentage points. So Trump lost 5% relative to Romney. On the other end of the education scale, the lower, Clinton wins college graduates by 10. She lost non-college graduates by 7. Among white college graduates, Trump won by 2. White non-college graduates, he beat her by 37 points. 37 points among white non-college graduates. And that was the difference in those states, Wisconsin, Michigan, Pennsylvania. These white working class voters, a lot of them who had been hit particularly hard by trade, lost jobs overseas, the one that Hillary had promised to close down the coal mines for, they voted. And they voted disproportionately for Donald Trump. In 2012, a lot of them didn't bother coming out for Mitt Romney. He just didn't appeal to them. Trump appealed to them. These are the people I saw at the rallies I went to. These are the people I talked to. And I can tell you, the biggest concern on their mind was economic anxiety. Time and time again, they complained not just about their particular position. In fact, it really wasn't that bad when I asked them how they were doing. It was their children's. They thought our economy was going in the wrong direction. Their children would have a less chance at the American dream than they did. They turned out and they voted overwhelmingly for Donald Trump, right? In fact, once you account for the educational difference, income doesn't seem to make much difference in vote choice. It's really driven by education. Now, we should be clear, Trump was smart enough to capitalize on a trend that dates back to really, Bill Clinton. He won the white vote without a college degree by 1%. These are sort of the New Deal Democrats. But over time, beginning with Bush, they have been gravitating Republican. But he really accentuated that trend. You can see this among particular key states. The Republican Party from 2012 to 2016 gained 12 points in Pennsylvania, 13 in Ohio, 17 in Michigan. These are all, again, those Rust Belt states. We can visualize this. These are counties in which Trump beat Romney by 12%. Again, this is the Rust Belt, right? Pennsylvania going, switching all the way into Ohio. He won Ohio a lot up into the Michigan area and, of course, down to Minnesota. Another way of looking at this, why didn't Clinton expand the map? She did. She actually gained support in red state strongholds like Arizona and Georgia. Texas had gone for Romney by 16 points. She cut it to 9 points. She really increased the support in California. Obama had beaten Romney by 23. She's going to win that by about 32%. A lot of this was because she boosted Latino support. But here's the problem. She did not boost it enough to flip the map, right? So even though she had gains in Texas and Georgia and Arizona, they went Republican still just by smaller margins. The rest of her population gain was in traditional blue states like California. Didn't help her in the Electoral College, right? Whereas Trump was more efficient in his gains. He gained among white Rust Belt voters in those crucial swing states that were already becoming closer. And so even though he just boosted support by a couple percentage points, that flipped those states. So looking ahead, if I'm a Democrat, what do I want to do? I may want to think more about returning to the New Deal focus on what's good for low-income, low-educated workers and win back those white voters in the Rust Belt rather than trying to maximize this growing demographic non-white vote that is a big part of the country, because they're not well distributed. They're in states that, for the most part, Democrats are already winning, right? All right, finish up with a couple of criticisms here. So one of the talking points that everyone says when a candidate wins and a candidate loses is the candidate that won, won because they were a genius. Whatever they were doing must have worked. And so one of the things we know, the Jared Kushner, Ivanka's husband, turned out to be a brilliant strategist, if you want to believe the post-election. And one of the things he did was they built a geolocation tool that plotted the location density of about 20 voter types over live Google Maps. So they broke the election down into different types of voters, about 20 voters. They said, okay, here is the white Catholic, low-income voter. And then they targeted their television ads very adroitly. You can do that in the digital age. So that instead of running nationwide television ads, they were being outspent, by the way, by Clinton's team, 3-1 on television ads, but they were more efficient in targeting them. My favorite story is they ran anti-immigration ads. And guess what shows they ran them on? How many here watch The Walking Dead? The Walking Dead? It's a story about our zombies overrunning our borders. That's where they ran their anti-immigration turf, right? So they were very strategic in targeting these ads, right? Meanwhile, Clinton, just to show you how punditry is really punditry, early in the campaign, the Clinton people had a very fawning story in Political Magazine. And this was about their mastermind, a guy named, I forget what his first name is, but his last name was Kriegel. And he was holed up in this room in Brooklyn, and reminiscent of A Beautiful Mind, that was the movie about John Nash, right? The brilliant mathematician who eventually went crazy. So I don't know if we want to use this for A Beautiful Mind. But anyhow, he had a computer algorithm. And that algorithm underlied nearly all of the Clinton campaign's most important strategic decisions. What cities was Clinton going to campaign in? What states was she going to compete in? When would she email supporters? What would those emails say? What doors would volunteers knock on? What phone numbers did they dial? Who gets Facebook? All of it was being running by this supercomputer, right? Which was programmed by this guy. And of course they said, this is before the election actually took place, his work isn't just powering Clinton's campaign, it is providing her a crucial tactical advantage in the campaign's final stretch. It's one reason her team is confident that they hold a distinctive edge. A beautiful mind. We all know how that turned out, right? That beautiful mind said, don't go to Wisconsin. You don't have to worry about Wisconsin. The computer data algorithm says so. So she didn't go to Wisconsin. These are the visits in the last 100 days. How many times did she go to Wisconsin? Zero, right? How many times to Michigan? Half as many as Trump. How many times to Florida? 10 times less. Ohio, 9 times less. Instead, she was in Arizona and Texas, expanding the map, because the beautiful mind told her that was the way to go, right? Turned out to be not so beautiful, right? The other thing she did, and you guys all saw this, she ran television ads. So political scientists have gone out and coded all these ads. This is from Lynn Vavrick, a very good political scientist. She coded each ad and weighted them by how many times the ads ran on television. So first of all, Clinton made more ads than Trump. She vastly out-advertised him, ran nearly 3 times as many ads she did. All told, over 500,000 ads. But here's what she put in those ads. More than 3/4 of those appeals in her advertisements, and nearly half of Trump's, were about his traits, characteristics, or dispositions. You might have seen some of these. Remember, she had the ad where Trump's words were being broadcast and kids were watching the TV and they were appalled. They had another ad that ran that talked about his comments about women and body shaming, fat shaming. And you looked at these and you said, these are powerful ads. Well, it turned out only 9% of her appeals were about the economy or jobs, right? Keep in mind, what did I say?
was motivating those Trump followers when I went to talk to him. I would ask them, did you hear what he said about Miss America? And they said, yeah, I don't care. That's not what this is election about. That's Donald Trump. It's all about the economy. They were paying no attention to the very things she was arguing were going to turn this election. And to show you how unusual this is, we have coded campaigns back to 1952. No campaign has ever made three-quarters of its ads about its opponent's traits. Never. It's just never happened. So she was doing something that was historically never done before, focusing on, of course, Donald Trump is a relatively unique candidate, and he's a big target, right? I'm not defending his remarks or his personal traits, but the reality is that's not what this campaign was about. It was, at least for those lower educated white voters, it was about economic anxiety, right? And we can see this. Realignments, everybody's talking about realignments. Lower class whites' realignments were preceding Trump's campaign. He recognized this. This is those southwestern Pennsylvania counties, those rural counties. Back in 2000, they went roughly about 55% for the Democratic Party, and they just began in 2004, 2008, 2012, trending Republican. This county is Allegheny County, this is Pittsburgh. Big African-American percentage. That didn't change at all. Trump saw this, and he said, I can win Pennsylvania if I concentrate on an economic message, which he did. Clinton did not, right? And we see the same thing. Raw votes for the Republican presidential candidate in these counties just going up. So Trump is capitalizing a trend that is there. He's not making this up himself. Conversely, the Democrats are increasingly the party of urban areas. This is Republican support in 92 core urban counties from 2000. You can see it's just dropping. Right? Just dropping. This basically breaks down regionally the support for Trump relative to Romney. So as a line goes up, that means Trump is doing better than Romney, and this is the percent of the population in each of these voting counties that is white and over 25 and doesn't have a college degree. Those are Trump supporters, basically. And as the percentage of those white, lower educated, over 25 voters goes up, his support relative to Romney goes up. The size of these are how many people are in each of those districts. He does better among the smaller districts relative to Romney. But look at, in the Midwest, that line is the sharpest. So that's where that Rust Belt is where he made up a lot of ground. Another way of looking at this, these are counties that had voted in the previous five elections the same way, but they changed in 2016. If they changed to Republicans, it's this color. If they change to Democrats, it's this color. And again, he was able to flip enough votes in this Rust Belt area. All right, the states that he improved on Romney, Wisconsin by 4%, Pennsylvania by 4%. And these are, again, important states because they're swing states. Michigan by 5%. He increases his share over Romney. Where does he lose? Well, he loses in California, but who cares? He loses in Texas, but who cares? Because he's got a huge lead in Texas. He's not going to win California. He loses in Massachusetts, but who cares, right? The states he's losing ground in aren't battleground states, either because they're solidly red or they're solidly blue, right? All right, this is a reminder for all the talk about how dramatic this change was. If you graph Romney's support in each state to Trump's support, they match up. This would be 50-50 line right here. If Trump did slightly better, he'd be slightly above the line. So you can see there's no realignment geographically speaking. He does well in the states that Romney did well. He does poorly, like Vermont, in the states that Romney did poorly. He just did a little better in enough of those states to win the Electoral College. So this wasn't a change election. I don't bother reading that. All right, last point. Stability marked the House and the Senate of 393 House incumbents who sought re-election. only 5 lost in the primaries, only 8 in the general election. That means 97% of incumbents won re-election. And not only did incumbents do well, of the 466 seats in the House and the Senate, 445 stayed in the same party. 96% of congressional seats stayed in the same party. So again, and if you're looking at the raw numbers, Democrats picked up about 6 House seats, they picked up 2 Senate seats, neither enough to regain a majority. So where are we? This is Democratic support when Barack Obama became president in 2008. This is the Senate. This is the House. This is state legislatures. This is the governors. And look what's happened. In his 8 years on watch, from here, they've lost 10% of their Senate seats. Democrats have lost nearly 20% of the House. They've lost 20% of seats in the legislatures. They've lost 35% of governors. The Democratic Party has gone from being the majority party when Barack Obama took office to being the minority party, not just in the presidency, in the House, in the Senate, but in governors and state legislatures. Right? It has been a total reversal. Of course, there's other factors that came into play. And I'm going to stop there because I just have a lot of other stuff. Let me take questions. So the question was, why didn't Hillary Clinton reprise her husband's famous message from 92 and 96 that it's the economy, stupid? And you remember when Bill Clinton ran, there was a concern that the Democratic Party had moved too far left. They were nominating people like Walter Mondale, George McGovern. Mike Dukakis had run in 1988. They were sort of big state liberal governors and senators, and the idea was Clinton, Bill, would move this party back to the center and make this economic appeal, and he was successful. And of course, the economy boomed while he was president. You know, it's going to be an enduring question. They thought, I think, when Donald Trump was the nominee, that he was such a big target based on what he had said. And they were also, I think, lulled a little bit into thinking that the Obama coalition was the Democratic coalition, that Clinton could recreate that coalition pretty much in its entirety. Now, let's be clear, she came pretty close, but again, just for want of a few thousand votes, well, 100,000, 200,000 really in 3 states, it lost the election. And again, she wins the popular vote, so this isn't a disaster. It's just marginally not enough for her to win the Electoral College vote. But sure, they're going to kick themselves, I think, and say, we just went overboard in sort of playing to what we perceive to be our opponent's weaknesses rather than playing up to our strengths. Why they did that? You know, we're going to have to wait for the memoirs to be written and the postmortems when people start, you know, getting in their circular firing squad. Already, I don't know if how many of you every 4 years, the campaign managers meet in Cambridge at the Institute of Politics. And they put together, they have a 3-day session, and it's recorded, and they get a nice little book out of it. And I assigned that book in my U.S. elections class, and I had Stuart Stevens, who ran the Romney campaign, come to speak to my elections class. And he talked about the respect he had for the Obama people, and the Obama people. David Axelrod said, what great job Stuart Stevens did. Well, the Democrats, Jennifer Palmieri, and the Republicans, Kellyanne Conway, got together, and their respect was about this deep. Jennifer opened up by saying, you know what, I'm glad we lost. If to win, we had to run a racist campaign like you did. And Kelly Conway said, really? I bet you would have run a racist campaign if you thought you could win. And they just started screaming at each other, right? It was like the most unprofessional meeting they've ever had. I can't wait to see the book version. So wounds are raw, but that's an illustration to me that they realize they screwed up. And here's the crowning lesson. If she really thinks Democrats lost because the opposing campaign got 46% of the popular vote by running, appealing to bigots and racists, the Democratic Party is in deep trouble. Deep trouble, right? If they lose their message. Yes, in the back. The question was, how many people didn't vote for Hillary because they were disgruntled by the primary process? So we know the youth vote was down slightly. Overall turnout actually was up from 2012. Do I have that data? I should have that data. I have lots of data. Come on, data. Don't tell me I didn't do that, data. Okay. No, darn. Turnout is about 59% of eligible voters. It was about 58%. So overall turnout was up, which you would expect in an open race. Turnout among some groups, as we talked about, was down among African Americans. Millennials tended not to vote. My students in the numbers that we expected, although they generally don't vote. Sanders, we don't have individual data on Sanders voters, but I think that's what you're driving at, right? A lot of polls suggested about 10% of Sanders supporters were going to vote for Trump. Now, we don't know how many actually did. We have to wait. It's going to be another few months before we get the individual voting records. Right now, we just have aggregate ones. I suspect it wasn't, in the end, what cost her the election, because a lot of Sanders people grumbled. But in the end, they thought they were going to vote the lesser of two evils, which was Hillary Clinton compared to Donald Trump. But I don't have clear-cut data on that. The question was whether there was, the people I talked to, were they concerned about income inequality because they were worried about their future and their children's future economically, but there are some people in the stratosphere who had no concerns at all. Those are the 1%, the billionaires. Right, to quote Bernie Sanders. Sorry, I couldn't help myself. I've been doing Bernie impressions all year. It's second nature to me now. Right? You know, the thing that got them more concerned, they said, I don't mind if the rich get theirs. As long as I know the old traditional American virtues, I work hard, I'm going to get ahead, pass something down to my children, they're going to get ahead. That's all we care about. So the income inequality wasn't resonating as much as this. This is, even though the domestic product, gross domestic product, has been growing, real medium income household has not. And that's what got them, right?
And they don't see that.
Well, they do, but they don't really care. They don't care about so much the wealthy as long as they were growing too. But they're not growing. So, you know, income inequality becomes an issue only because not so much of the inequality, but the bottom rung. The inequality is because the bottom rung is not growing and the top rung is. So yeah, that was an issue, but not directly. They never said income inequality to me. Americans generally don't think of that. They don't think of class-based distinctions. They just basically think of upward social mobility. Is my kid, are they going to do better than I'm going to do? And the evidence, particularly among white voters, is their income has just been stagnant. In fact, if you graph disposable income, African Americans and Latino income is nowhere near where white income is, but it's been steadily going up. Not for white males. White males has actually been stagnant for close to 35 years now. And that's, again, what Trump is capitalized on. Yes, you right there.
Maybe you put in to like Obama's remark about some Republicans won because Fox News was in every bar across America. Right. How much, you know, we spend a lot of time on screen time, virtual reality, kind of like the artillery softening up the people so that they move in certain directions.
Actually, Fox News is the biggest news of broadcast of the cable, but most people don't watch cable. The majority of Americans still get their news from the regular broadcast channels. And so that Fox News and those mouthpieces are Rachel Maddow and MSNBC. They're basically speaking to they're preaching to the choir. So there's not a lot of conversion that's going on. There is a lot of mobilization that's going on. But there's not a lot of evidence that they're persuading people who might go either way. They listen to Fox News and they decide, yeah, Barack Obama is actually a Muslim who was born in Africa and I'm going to vote for Mitt Romney or vice versa. The people who are sort of predisposed to believe that weren't going to vote for Barack Obama anyhow. So our best guess is it had less of an impact than you might think, all that cable news. So the question was, I thought the Electoral College was created to prevent the people from electing buffoons. And you already are seeing isolated instances of which electors in various states are saying, I will not cast my ballot for Donald Trump. We'll see how widespread this so-called faithless elector is. There have been instances, maybe two dozen, in which this has happened in history. You're absolutely right. As originally designed, the Electoral College was supposed to be an independent body of virtuous individuals who were beholden to nobody, and they would just choose the person who was most qualified to lead the country. That lasted about 4 years. And then political parties began to develop. They began to get electors to run and pledge beforehand. When their candidate won the popular vote, all those electors then went and cast the vote accordingly. I doubt if you're counting on the Electoral College reverting back to the way it was in 1788 and saying, Donald Trump's no George Washington, I'm voting for someone else. I mean, there are all sorts of interesting permutations. You know, if nobody gets a majority of Electoral College votes, it goes into the House, and then states voting individually as states, each state gets one vote, chooses, well, the Republicans are still going to choose Trump. So that's not going to make any difference. 29 states basically forbid their electors from defying the will of the popular vote, but there is no penalty. So in Vermont, for instance, it's written into our state law that electors must abide by the popular will. What's the penalty if they don't? There is no penalty. I talked to Governor Douglas, who had served many years as Secretary of State. I said, what if you were the Secretary of State and the Vermont Republican slate of electors said, we're not voting for Donald Trump. What are you going to do? He said, "This probably I would go to the courts and ask for an injunction, and then the Republican Party would ask all of these electors to step down and would replace them to people who would do the party will." Some electors are doing that. Some electors are voluntarily stepping down. I think that's the way you probably should do it in this day. But if you're counting on the Electoral College to save us from Donald Trump, dream on, teen queen. It's not going to happen.
Why did the pundits get it so wrong on the Hispanic vote or the Latino vote? Even in the days immediately before the election and election night itself, they were talking about Latinos streaming to the polls. And it looked like many people thought that that was going to be enough to put her over.
Okay, so the first question is, why did the pundits get it wrong about the Latino vote? It looked like they were streaming to the polls and that they were going to be a potent force here. So the short answer is, one of the things we've learned is, in contrast to African Americans, who in terms of voting are a relatively monolithic block, when we speak of the Latino vote, they're a much less homogeneous voting block. So you have Cubans who are really typically voting Republican. Historically, you know, you have third generation Latinos, first generation Latinos. In states like Colorado and Nevada, they did turn out early. They voted heavily for Hillary Clinton, and they pushed those states in her direction. So she did better in Nevada than a lot of our predictions. But, you know, the bottom line is Donald Trump, to a certain extent, was right. His sort of populist message appealed to a small proportion of Latinos, but it appealed to them. You know, I had this great conversation with a student of mine. She's from East Los Angeles, a heavily Latino district. She's Mexican heritage. And I asked her, you know, why didn't the Latino vote, after all those comments Trump made, why didn't it just swing heavily? And she said, I'll tell you an incident. I was in the laundromat with my mother, and we got into a little pushing fight to get access to a machine with this other person. And after that person left, I said, you know, Mom, what was that all about? And she said, oh, those El Salvadorians. Right? They just came over the border. Yeah. I just got citizenship. You know, I worked my way up. Damned if I'm going to let these people, you know, it's the ones hanging on the bottom rung of the ladder that are hanging on most tightly. So there was an element of that involved. The Latino vote, you know, to put it crudely, it's often said that the African American vote has been bought and paid for by Democrats. Latinos are only for rent, right? So when when George Bush was president from 2000 to 2004, the Latino vote was trending Republican. They just have not become as wedded to one party as you might expect. Second part of your question.
Yeah, so as an expert on the presidency.
Who's that?
You.
I said Donald Trump will be out in 3 weeks.
What kind of a president is Trump going to be?
You know, it's so much of this is, the question was, what kind of a president will Donald Trump be? A big part of that answer is who he surrounds himself with, right?
more than the case for any president in recent memory, I fear for this country if he surrounds himself with inexperienced people. He's, you know, despite the sort of caricature that this guy is a buffoon and says bad, dumb, stupid things, well, okay, he does, but he's a smart guy. He's shown an ability to surround himself with smart people, but that's in the business sector. Governing is different than business. My biggest worry is this guy continues to take everything personally, and he's, you know, he has all the characteristics of an impulsive individual, which is not a temperamental trait that you want in your president. Now, having said that, when you sit in the Oval Office, and I've talked to former White House aides who have worked with presidents, something happens to the individual. You go from campaigning against somebody to standing for something. And hopefully that something is not just your own party, but the country as a whole. So I hold out hope when he's sitting there in the Oval Office and recognizes what's at stake here, that he becomes more presidential. But God, I hope he surrounds himself. I mean, here's a great indication. If Mitt Romney, who he has systematically humiliated over the last 3 weeks by making him come in and grovel to get the Secretary of State job, if in the end Trump gives him the Secretary of State's job as opposed to Rudy Giuliani, that's a sign to me that this guy gets it, that he understands there's something bigger at stake here. I cannot make a prediction on how this guy's going to govern. There is a potential for him to be a very good president, only in the sense that he is not locked into the partisan divisions. You know, he's talked about infrastructure spending. He's talked about talking with the Russians. I mean, in theory, he's more open-minded in terms of working across the aisle than we've seen in recent years. So there's a potential for big change. There's also a potential for disaster. So I think he's one of these high-risk, potentially high-reward presidents, but I wouldn't go beyond that. Way in the back, yes. So the question was whether the Trump election fits with a larger global movement towards right-wing authoritarian governments, right? We've seen the Italian government just fell, the French, the Conservative Party, Le Pen has gained support. The vote on Brexit to exit the European Union passed. And it is true that in times of economic discontent, countries tend to go one of two ways. They tend to move in a very progressive, you know, Venezuela under Chavez type direction, or they tend to move into a more populist right-wing authoritarian perspective. For whatever reason, we're seeing populism, right-wing populism, authoritarianism attract more support. Having said that, I would be very careful extrapolating what's happening globally to the United States, because we are so distinctive in our political culture. We have a much more racially diverse population. Our minorities are much better integrated. They're not perfectly integrated. They're much better integrated. Our support for our institutions is much stronger than individuals in other countries. So I would not go so far as to say Trump is the epitome of the right-wing authoritarian figure like Putin is in Russia. I don't see that. Having said that, you know, this is an ongoing experiment in the United States. There's no guarantee that it's always going to turn out well. And, you know, there are troubling signs that we should be careful about in terms of who Trump surrounds himself with and the degree to which the bad influences become disturbingly pronounced. So I think that's a great question. Yeah. So that's the question I get. I thought this would be the first question. If only Bernie had run, the Democrats would have won. That is a hypothetical that will remain a hypothetical. We can't rerun the election under all conditions. For what it's worth, Bernie got about 18,000 votes in Vermont, outpolled the third parties. That's why, by the way, Mitt Romney won 2 Vermont towns and Donald Trump won about 60 Vermont towns. It's not because Vermont has suddenly shifted right. It's because Bernie Sanders took a lot of votes away from Hillary Clinton. And so in those states, Donald Trump won about 60 votes. I, for what it's worth, and now I'm speaking less on data and more as a pundit, I don't think Bernie Sanders would have done better. And the reason is because Bernie Sanders,
His message on income inequality and trade resonated very well. His solutions, probably not as well. He really was pushing a progressive agenda. Now, whether you agree with that agenda or not, as much as we can glean from our polling data, the majority of the country, I hate to say it, but the rest of the world is not as blue and as liberal as Vermont. And he would have been attacked for a lot of his voting records. He would have been held out as sort of a socialist. And that word socialist still scares a lot of older Americans. Younger Americans don't mind socialists, so they don't know what the hell it means. But older Americans, socialism is antithetical about what's good about our country, right? And I think in many ways, he would have been a vulnerable candidate. That, however, is a guess. What was the first part of your question? Well, the one thing Sanders taught them is you gotta have a message, right? You gotta have a message. It's not enough to run against the other guy. You gotta have a message. Sanders had a message, right? And I think the second point that Sanders brought home is identity politics is not enough, right? You're not enough simply to ask people to vote for you because you're a member of a racial or ethnic group that historically has done well by our party. You gotta give them a positive message, and it has to address pocketbook concerns. If I'm the Democratic Party, that's the lesson I take from this election. And again, it's not clear that a lot of these leading Democratic pundits get this, because they're all about, it was all about racism. And if that's all they focus on, God help the Democratic Party, because they're gonna lose a generation of low-income voters. Yes? Yep, so the question was the role of the superdelegates in the Democratic Party, which sort of, in the end, elected the party insider versus the Republican Party that has no superdelegates to speak of, and they elected the party outsider. For what it's worth, the Democratic Party has agreed, based on Bernie Sanders' instigation, to reconsider the role of superdelegates. They're moving to removing them in the next electoral cycle. Having said that, Bernie Sanders lost the popular vote to Hillary Clinton in the Democratic primary. So it wasn't simply the case that the superdelegates pushed her over the top. She basically had broader appeal. Bernie's Achilles heel, he could not expand his support among the white, beyond white voters. He just could not draw on African Americans in particular, who are roughly 30 to 35% of the Democratic constituency. So that, more than the superdelegates, really hurt him. But the superdelegate issue is one that has struck a chord. And the Sanders people are, there's gonna be a committee appointed to reconsider that, and I wouldn't be surprised if they're done away with. Of course, they were brought in to help the party elect in a more electable candidate. So the irony here is, within a generation, they've decided, oops, no, we'll go back to the way it used to be. Yes?
How is this not a change election?
How is this not a change election? That is a great question. It's a change election if we elected a non-politician. So, you know, how is this not a bad play, Mrs. Lincoln? Well, it was well acted. It's not a change election in this sense. The voting coalition that Trump put together was remarkably similar to the voting coalition that Mitt Romney put together. Just a few more in key states, lower income white voters. And in the composition of the vote, the same demographic groups that supported Barack Obama supported Hillary Clinton, just in slightly lower percentages in key states. If you look at the House, the Democrats picked up 6 seats. 97% of incumbents who ran for re-election won. So in the way we measure change, do you have new people in because new voting coalitions developed, voting for parties that they normally didn't support? We saw none of this, right? We just saw none of this. So that's why we're trying to push back against the media every 4 years. Oh my Lord, it's an entirely new election. And of course, the election itself changes on a daily basis if you're following the media. We tend to focus on the forest. The pundits focus on the trees. If you look at the forest, it's a pretty familiar forest. Does that sort of answer it? Yep. Yes, way in the back. Great question. So voter ID laws, did voter ID laws have any impact? We know that voter ID laws, any regulation designed to, for principled reasons or not, that are designed to make it harder to vote by requiring people to provide education have a disproportionate impact on lower educated, lower income voters. And it turns out that means Democrats. So to the extent that you require, typically it means Democrats, a photo ID or something, our studies show, controlling for all other factors, the imposition of voter ID laws tend to depress turnout disproportionately among Democrats. Having said that, it's very hard to estimate how much that cost Hillary Clinton in states like Wisconsin and Michigan and Pennsylvania. She actually didn't do as well in states that did not have draconian voter ID laws as well. So my blanket, and again, we have to do more studies on this. We're still relatively early in the process of going through the individual voter databases. Ask me back in 6 months, I'll have a better answer for you. But my short answer is it probably didn't help her. I can't say that it cost her the election in any of those states, but it probably made it closer than it would have been otherwise. Yes? I thought the media did a deplorable job, and I choose that word judiciously, in this election. Part of it now, the tweeting, they don't really control. That is a direct, all you have to do, and I hope all of you sign up to the president's Twitter feed. If you're not on Twitter, how many here are on Twitter? It's sort of a generational thing. I see that. Get on Twitter, it's worth the entertainment value. You wake up in the morning and you see the president of the United States has just tweeted something in 140 characters, like Hillary Clinton still whining, sad, or, you know, we're invading Iraq. Make America great, or something like this. So that is part of his appeal. He mastered social media in a way that no other candidate has. And he had a huge follower. And it spoke, social media is good not only for getting your message out, but for raising money and doing all sorts of things. The establishment media is in a fiscal crisis in this country. They are losing money hand over fist. They are losing audiences, particularly, you know, the print media and the broadcast stations. And Donald Trump was manna from heaven. As much as they won't admit it, he was a ratings boom. And they couldn't wait to have him on. And he would say something outrageous, and they would say, tisk, tisk. Did you see what he said? Did you hear what he said? It's horrible. It's so horrible, we're going to talk about it for the next 24 hours. Right? And the ratings went up. And Trump realized this. Meet the Press, the venerable Meet the Press, the longing running, had a long-running standard. If you did not come on our stage to talk to us, unless there's dire circumstances, we would not have you on as a guest. That went out the window in 1 week when Donald Trump started saying, nah, I can't go on studio. I'll talk to you on the phone. Chuck Todd said, I'm a principal newsman. Quick, call him up, yeah. Right? So the media, you know, they did not cost Hillary Clinton this election, but they're, you know, they were just part of the problem here. And going forward, it's unclear, you know, I hate to say this, but one of my worries is that they now have decided to compensate, they're going to be the loyal opposition and criticize everything Trump does. And I don't think that's any better either. I would like the media to report the news. Tell me what happened, right? That's all I want. Well, I better stop there when you're applauding. That's probably as good as it's going to get. Thank you very much for everything.